Gigantic from the album Surfer Rosa from 1988, and we welcome back David Lovering and Joey Santiago from the Pixies. Hello, gentlemen. Good to see you.
Hello,
Pete. How are you?
I'm reasonably well. How are you two?
Very well.
Good.
It only seems like, you know, it must have made a great impression on me last time, because it only feels like it's 5 minutes since we last met. So. And it was sometimes before it was the winter, which I have no recollection of.
Yeah. Time is...
We were placing it was November, I think, early November. We were here last.
Doing what? Just talking about the doing some shows.
We were doing shows. We were on tour, right?
I say a couple of years all the time. If someone tells me, like,
if
doing?
I'm struggling, I mean, I suppose it's your life, isn't it? Because when you're asked about things, because you're so much traveling, you're in airport lounges. It's all the same thing. I bet you haven't got a clue where you've been half the time.
Sometimes I wake up, I don't even know what country I'm in.
Ah, well, that's quite weird.
Nice, yeah.
Because you're kind of at those early, that first minute of the waking day, you think you're trying to focus on your day, and you think, and to find yourself in another country, not in your own bed, is quite strange. It's just completely disconcerting. It's like having permanent jet lag, isn't it? Surfer Rosa, 1988, and Gigantic, we've just heard. Who wants to tell me something about that record? Because it's something that I've noticed. Time does make a difference to these to the songs and your past. What has changed when you listen back to that record?
Well, Gigantic, the whole inspiration for that was we wanted to sell cell phones. So we had to we had to change the key, and David, you had to do something with the beat because it didn't sound like a. We wanted Apple,
right? Okay,
we didn't want like this is the other. You know, we would try to get Apple. Yeah. So
it is before the phone, isn't it? The explosion of the personal.
Well, we knew it was going to come out.
Looking towards the future, then.
Yeah.
David is sat there slightly bemused by that. Did we actually try and get on a phone out in those days?
Oh, 1988 you're talking about there?
Yes, I think, yes.
That was a fairly quick record to make, wasn't it? It was.
It was 2.5 weeks, if I think correctly.
Yeah.
That's like the old punk days, isn't it?
Yeah, they just put a microphone up, or Steve Albini just put a microphone up, and we just played.
Mm-hmm.
And that was it.
Just room mics and some close mics, that was it. And plus... We had played these songs in Boston this was our first real recording other than a demo that we did.
Yeah, yeah.
So we knew these songs. They weren't anything that we... Some of them we had to work out within the last couple of months. But most of them we knew for a while because we played them in clubs around Boston.
Yeah.
So it was very easy to record because we were all confident and we knew how the songs went.
Yeah, yeah. Somebody told me about Steve Albini. He's a man of few words. He would sit there and not say a great deal. Is that true?
Well, he liked to tell stories.
He told me if I was to do interviews or something to call him like a dick or something, you know? So, I'm going to piss him off and say he was peachy.
He was a nice guy.
Yeah, he had flowers and he kept trying to give me a massage. It kind of got creepy.
Right. Okay. Somebody said he's there playing cards and gaming things on the computer, playing games all the time. Which is a bit off when you're trying to record a record, I suppose.
No, he was. His mind was at work, I think.
Yeah. Let's talk about the new. Let's talk about the new record. I've transported you back to 88. I can see it's a little fuzzy. I mean, I couldn't tell you what I was doing in 88. I tell you, I have no idea. But the new record. This is a process that you've been making. You started to record Size over the last 18 months ago. Tell me the start of the beginning, because you weren't even sure if these records, these sides were going to make these sessions were going to make an album. Is that right?
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. Initially, it was just going to be an EP.
Right.
Just to take the pressure off.
Yeah,
you know, because we were thinking about an album thing. Let's just, you know, take it small bites.
Four songs is all we needed, we thought.
Yeah.
What? How many songs? Four.
Four.
Just four originally. This was a while ago, years ago.
Yeah.
That was our train of thought.
Well, you're testing the water a little bit then by, you know, seeing what the reaction would be to new material, because it's always you can do a lot of good work, can't you?
We did everything all in one swoop, the whole recording. So. It was all planned as far as the release of those EPs, EP1, EP2, EP3.
Mm.
We didn't tell anyone. We thought they were nice surprises along the way. First of all, Bag Boy, that's a great surprise, it's new music. And then EP1 pops, it doesn't suggest anything. Then EP2 comes, surprise,
all right.
And EP3.
Yeah.
And eventually, here we are now with Indie Cindy, the full album of everything.
And people are...
EP1 suggests there's going to be another one, right?
Well, not really. It doesn't, really, you know?
Was it ever called EP1?
I know what you mean. I know, right?
Like Led Zeppelin 1, maybe? You know?
It seems to me like when you were tentatively trying to find out which way it would go then at that stage, because, you know, I think there's nothing worse than the big announcement that Pixies are back with a brand new album, because, you know, the pressure is on, isn't it?
Oh, yeah, but I don't think we weren't searching for any information to gather from it.
Right.
It was just, here it is, and it's going to come out in these little batches. But.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
Tell me about Indie Cindy, the track we're going to play, because I believe this could well have been from the first session. In fact, maybe the first thing you did back together after a while. Is that right?
I remember for me, this one was scary because I had worked out all the drum parts for everything else, but this one was daunting. And it took me a long time, and I was really frightened of going into the studio, not being able to play it. But I finally got it down, and then when I got it down, I realized, wow, it wasn't as bad as I thought. So I'm very happy with it.
Joey, do we have same?
The antidote there is, you know, that talking bit? You know, there's a talking bit there. Yeah. I recorded that in the hotel room.
Right.
When I met Charles in Massachusetts. Cause I was just recording him, and Gil said, that sounds the best.
That's really from that, it's
a secret of mine.
Do you know what I didn't ask you about last time? I know we're going to talk about the brand new record, and I didn't ask you about your magic tricks. I know you're just done with an elastic band.
So. No, I don't know. I don't push magic on anyone, or I don't bring it up. But if it does come up, I'll talk about it.
Have you found a way of integrating the music of the Pixies with magic, or is it all magic to you anyway?
Well, I actually did open up for the Pixies, I think, twice with my stage show. Actually, here in London at the at Brixton. That's the most I've incorporated, just opening up for the band or just even backstage or at, you know, after shows. I'll do magic like I've showed you, Pete. You know, something close up. Something close up and intimate is much more powerful than a stage show, in my opinion.
Do you bother with the cards or not? Is that not for
you?
Oh,
I do. I love cards. Okay. It's one of my fortes. But I don't bring cards up just because usually when I start with cards, everyone thinks of, oh no, here's my grandfather's trick. You know, there's not many good card tricks that a lot of people just have in their memory. So.
I mean, because we were just outside just a moment. I said, have you got a trick for me? You pulled out a couple of elastic bands and did something. It was quite clever. Yes. But I can see Joey sat there going, rolling the eyes into his back of his head.
Oh, no, I wasn't.
He knows all my presentation lines.
Yeah. But I mean, you know, that you must see, you know, that kind of magic going on, and you're thinking, he's pretty good, isn't he?
I can never figure it out, you know. So it's pretty neat. I do like people's reactions are always different.
Yeah.
So it's cool, you know?
Yeah, yeah. And if I'm one of those people on the telly, you might be doing the same yourselves. When I see some trick and I see a sleight of hand, I'm freezing it and doing all that. Are you aware of David Devant as being a musician?
Oh, yes.
Founder of Magic Circle.
Magic Circle, which I've been there once a couple of years ago. But I'm a member of the Magic Castle. So I'm lucky because if I have that membership, I'm able to get into the Magic Circle when I'm here in London.
And what is this mythical Magic Circle? Is it a Magic Circle of people sat around in some darkened room covered in cobwebs, or is it?
Well, there's not that much. It's a magical place. There's a lot of magic shows that happen there. They have a bar.
It's all right.
It's good. Liquor and magic. Liquor and magic go to well. But the thing is, you know, it's all the name magicians. You know, when I'm there, you see everybody.
All right.
And it's the same thing in the Magic Castle. It's like every name magician is there. And people move just to be close to these places because they are meccas for magic and for sharing and doing magic. Mm. So it's a wonderful thing.
I'll involve Joey before you start to fall asleep. Joey was talking about magic when we should be talking about your new record. In an odd sort of way, the Pixies in their own musical way have made a lot of magic over the years. Very fond. People are very fond of the Pixies and what they represent, especially in the UK. I don't know how big your career was at its height in the States, but certainly here there was a period where you were one of the biggest bands that would come to the UK. Were you aware of, you know, how well you were doing in the UK compared to your success in America?
Yes. And No, actually, no.
I don't think so.
I mean,
you really represented a period in music, you know. Here.
We call this our home.
Yeah.
Our home base. Our record company was from here, and
you
know, we got to credit one DJ that really made us aware of our music.
Yeah.
And you know, it's
Yeah. His name is John
Peel.
Peel.
Yeah. Yes. No longer with us. But
I know. So, yeah. So
how big did your career get then? Back home in the States, did you creep into the top 40 there, or the Billboard, or anything?
Maybe once. Maybe did we once? On the modern college rock chart or something like that.
You're confusing me now, but there's so many charts, isn't
it? It wasn't the regular rock chart.
Yeah, it was the charts we made up.
Yeah, but yeah. We were never... No,
it was the CMJ. CMJ chart.
So you've always been on the periphery as far as you're concerned in America?
Yeah, I mean, recently it's changed a lot in the last... since we broke up. It's now America kind of, you know, they're on the bandwagon as well.
Yeah,
but back then it wasn't as much so as Europe and the rest of the world that were really the fans of us. Mm-hmm.
And you're going to come back, Tea in the Park, July the 11th, and you're headlining Field Day on June the 8th. Is that a new festival, or am I just falling a little bit behind the times?
I don't think it's the first time.
All right. Okay. Sounds like a big one. So I think it's going to be a big headlining show.
I like it. It's in the city.
Yeah. Going out to play the shows at the moment. Is it the emphasis on the new material? Because obviously people want to hear the material, but you know, people still want the songs that raise the roof off the theatre, don't they? Still, you're shouting stuff for the. So how do you plan integrating the old and the new stuff together? Is it just completely 50-50 split and that's it?
No. Like depending on the length of the set, it'll be like 4 or 5.
New songs.
Yeah.
New songs. Yeah.
No, so that's maybe an hour and a half, 90 minutes. So in that, there's 28 songs. So.
Just like back then, you know, when we put Bossa Nova out, we wouldn't play all of it.
Right.
We'd play 4 and stuff because people aren't familiar with it yet. Mm. So.
I don't know if you heard about the Cure. They recently did a 3.5-hour set.
Oh boy!
Yeah, it's a big act. It's a tough ask, isn't it? Really?
Yeah.
I saw Springsteen, and that was about that long.
That's way too long. My favorite gig, I have to say, is Morrissey. He did an hour at a place I'm from, at Manchester Apollo. I think you played the Apollo in Manchester. Great little gig, and it was 55 minutes an hour. I just thought it was just left people wanting for more.
I agree.
It was quite it was banging out and. I still remember that for one reason it didn't go on long enough, and I mean that's
what I like about the majority of Pixie songs is that they're maybe a minute 10, minute 30. That means if you like them, you want more. If you don't like them, it's done.
Well, I think Buddy Holly's Every Day was only like 1:58, wasn't it? It's nothing unusual in rock and roll that when we first began, there's records that are great, blistering records. Some of the Elvis ones were 1:50. By the time you looked at the watch, the thing is over. Monkey's Got to Heaven, the Doolittle album, is now 25 years old. I keep reminding you of, you know, how long it's been and what you've achieved in that time, because we were talking about Surfer Rosa from 88. And if we look at, for me, your greatest album... Is that the phone going off, David? Are you making something disappear? We didn't hear it, so... But 25 years of an album which was fondly thought of again in this country, and one of those big albums of... that particular year, and it was all going off here because we had, you know, that Manchester scene and everything, and in between all of that was your record Monkeys Go to Heaven that played on daytime record radio, which was a real breakthrough moment. I don't expect you ever got made mainstream daytime radio at home, did you?
No,
not at all.
With that album.
Not with that song.
Mm-hmm.
Oddly enough, I kind of don't like that song.
You really don't?
I don't. Isn't that weird? I mean, I don't get why it's our biggest song at all. I don't get it. Which says a lot about me.
It was the mainstream record here. Then, and from that point, then you know the Pixies' history began really in its second phase, didn't it?
Yeah, I think it was definitely a huge album.
Yeah, it's either that or Surfer Rosa. There's two camps of the spectrum sometimes.
Looking forward to the Tea in the Park July the 11th and then headlining at the Field Day on June the 8th are the two big shows we can look forward to. And you've been using various bass players along the way. Who's with you at the moment? Who's likely to be with you?
Roslyn Shanton is our current bass player, and we are so happy with her. She's amazing. She's an incredible bass player. She sings great. The audience loves her. She's making me play better.
Oh, well, that's impressive.
I would be embarrassed if I, you know, so I've got to keep up with her, but it's all great.
What about you, Joey? A little bit of
rhythm section's good, I could just, I could just make mistakes all over the place.
Without feeling too embarrassed about the whole thing.
As long as people are dancing.
Yeah, we're going to end off our little conversation with Greens and Blues. Mm. Who wants to tell us? It'd be nice to know something about a brand new song that's fairly relatively new. Who wants to start?
It seems to be a crowd favourite.
Yeah,
I'm picking up right now from what I understand.
Yeah. I mean, if it was the old days, this could be like, you know, that you could see the record as Zach saying, this is a hit record. Couldn't you know that?
I mean, it struck me. Are you kidding? Greens and Blues? But yeah, I guess so. But
man,
it's one of my hardest ones to play.
Right.
Just because it's kind of it's a little slower tempo and it's kind of tough to play slow. But we've been getting better and better at it because we've been playing these songs since September. And we're honing them in much better, all the new songs.
They're all sounding great.
We're happy with this.
Joey, Magdalena's good, yeah.
Yeah, what about Green and Blues for you? Can you tell us anything about the writing of this? The Greens and Blues? Tell us about it.
I mean, it's great.
Yeah.
And when we play it for radio stations, Paz has a violin that she plays along with it. But I like the song, you know. I mean, it's great. Everything about it just went really quickly, everything.
Mm. It appears it could be the standout track on the album.
And we think it's about the planet Earth. Is that correct?
Is it too early to predict what you might be up to in the near future, or are you just playing this record through and then seeing how things are at the end of the year?
That's our focus right now.
Would you like it? Do you not want it to end? Would you like it to carry on?
I mean, it's a topic of conversation when Chucky and I having drinks, you know.
What
just
is the
concepts of the next record?
Right, okay.
Stuff like that, you know.
It's a
fun subject to talk about, you know, the future.
Well, I mean, essentially, you need to get on in order to make more music together, don't you? Especially you three need to get on and sit down and be able to get on and be friends.
Yes. Mm-hmm,
And is that happening?
I believe it might.
Right. Okay. Yeah. You'd make a great politician, Joey. You really would. But
and I'm a magician, so I'll leave it as a surprise.
Magician, politician. Oh, you could probably rule the world between the two of you, couldn't you? And all right, Greens and Blues is from the new Pixies album. Back to play the Tea in the Park on July the 11th, headlining Field Day on June the 8th. Always a pleasure to talk to you, David Lovering and Joey Santiago.
Pleasure.
All the best, and enjoy your summer playing these records out. Thank you.
Thank you.